Today, of course, we are going to cover diabetes, which I think is one of the most common diseases which cause issues as far as any age group is concerned, and even more so in the old age. As you all know, diabetes is the disease that develops when the amount of sugar in your blood becomes too high. So it's of two types. Yeah, one is when your body is not able to make enough insulin, and second is when you develop resistance to insulin, which is when you actually grow older. So type 1 and type 2. Type 2 diabetes is more likely to occur in older adults. As you age, your body's ability to process sugars obviously decreases. And things like being overweight also leads to a great chances of you developing diabetes. Now, you can always prevent or delay getting the type 2 diabetes and lower the risk of heart disease by basically losing your weight and also increasing your level of physical activity. So diabetes is very, very common, and older adults with diabetes are at a higher risk of things like incontinence, falls, memory problems, even depressive symptoms. And the complications of diabetes can cause a lot of disability. It can lead to a hampering of day-to-day activities, especially with walking. And those with diabetes having complications like the nerve involvement, the eye involvement, and of course the kidney involvement to a great extent can cause issues. So the primary responsibility of managing the diabetes is never the doctors. It's actually the patient and as well as the caregiver who needs to help, because ultimately diabetes as always has to be brought under control. And it is something we know that we can't entirely reverse, but we can get it under control under manageable sort of levels. Now, the risk factors for diabetes, of course, in any age, of course, in older age as well, is being overweight, obese, then having more abdominal fat, that is fat around the middle part of the body, a lack of exercise, lack of activity, then family history of diabetes. Yeah, if you have a family history of diabetes, the risk of diabetes can increase. High alcohol consumption, having high blood pressure, having a higher amount of cholesterol. Stress plays a very important role in development and worsening of diabetes. Then, of course, certain medications like steroids. Now, waistlines. Waistlines are very, very important. Your waist measurement can be a warning sign for diabetes. If anything above 40 in males and 35 in females, it is a higher risk of diabetes. Then usually symptoms of diabetes which are there include, one is there is increased thirst, then increased appetite will be there, frequently you have to pass urine, sometimes it is as often as even every hour, unusual weight loss or weight gain can happen, severe fatigue, if there is too much of sugar, the fatigue is there, loss of energy, then wounds will heal slowly. As you go ahead, there could be complications of the foot with only a podiatrist can take place, for example, a foot ulcer, foot sores, numbness or tingling sensation in the feet and hand, a lot of times confusion, depression, and to a great extent also sexual dysfunction. If you have diabetes but you don't have any symptoms, you still are at high risk. So your screening of diabetes is very, very important. Now, how do you diagnose diabetes and how do you test it? Diagnosis, of course, is done with a very simple blood test, which is the fasting blood sugar, as well as something known as a postprandial blood sugar, that is after eating, 2 hours after eating. Then also there is something known as an oral glucose tolerance test, in which your blood sample is taken after giving you a sugary beverage after 2 to 3 hours again. One of the most important tests which actually helps us in establishing the diagnosis of diabetes is to do a HbA1c. Now, HbA1c usually helps us in getting to know whether how good control of diabetes
continue. Yeah, am I more better audible now?
Definitely.
Eating is concerned, it is basically a fasting blood sugar as well as a blood sugar after eating, which is known as postprandial, which is done around 2 hours after the eating is done. Then one of the very important tests is the HbA1c, which is known as the hemoglobin A1c, which is usually done so that we get the control of every 3 months. For example, it helps us in knowing whether your sugars were at the control at all. Because a lot of times, I mean, this is not exactly because older people want to do it, but a lot of times nearer to the appointments, a lot of older people try to control their sugars and then their blood sugars seem okay. But then it is actually when we see the HbA1c, we realize that overall the blood sugars have not been that controlled over around period of 3 months. So that's why HbA1c is very important. And age-wise, I would say anything HbA1c less than 7 is good, but more than 7 is sort of not really acceptable. If there is multiple medical problems, then 8 to 8.5 also we can see, but then it is quite high, and we need to make sure that as of course the age increases and the number of diseases are more, I would always say that I am worried more about the sugar going down rather than the sugars being high. Then as far as caring for patients with diabetes is concerned, of course there are medications which you know, non-insulin and insulin. Or non-insulin medications, many medications are there. I wouldn't want to go into very much details. And insulin. Now, most older people do not like injections, so we try to basically start them first on diet, exercise, and non-insulin medications so that their blood control can be reached. However, there has to be good amount of testing which has to be done, especially sugars. So that's why diabetic should always have the glucometers at home so that they're obviously able to sort of connect and see whether. I think I'm not getting a good network, so I'll continue as far as the audio is concerned. So as I was saying, to control your blood sugars is very, very important that you monitor it, actually having glucometers at home. So you can do self-monitoring also, and after some time, of course, you can also try to monitor it at home, maybe even in the lab tests in between. Now, HbA1c level is important. Why? Because it helps us what kind of control you actually have. So try to always get the HbA1c done at least once in a year, and if needed, we will obviously advise you if more. Now, other investigations and care, which is very, very important, I feel, is if you have diabetes long standing, then you need to. If you have diabetes long standing, then you need to check for your eye, your retina. So you have to check for your ophthalmology consultation, which has to be done yearly. Then you need to get an ultrasound to see the size of the kidneys, and also do your urine testings to see if you're actually losing protein, because that is also something which is very, very important. And thirdly, if you get symptoms like numbness or tingling sensation, so that is also something which is, I think, very important. That might be showing us that you might actually have involvement of the nerves. So in that case, we need to have more stricter control as far as sugars are concerned, and also maybe you'll have to do your nerve testing. Now, there are very important methods to actually control or manage your diabetes. See, remember, the diabetes control, the D as far as doctor is concerned, does not come in. The D is actually you have to do proper diet, you have to have determination, dedication, and devotion as far as taking care of your diabetes is concerned. The control of diabetes is in your hands and it is not in our hands. So that's why try to choose healthy, low-calorie foods. We often advise for older people to take false, frequent meals rather than large meals so that at least the glucose level is in control throughout. Now, this helps us in management in both ways. It shouldn't go too low, and it shouldn't go too high as well. So we need to actually maintain them at good levels. Second is exercise. Exercise is very important because you need to have physical activity to actually burn the calories and to make sure that your sugar is under control. Now, to be educated about diabetes is also very important. You should know what kind of symptoms are there, what is the control you need to have. You need to be especially know if you are taking insulin, then you need to know how to take insulin, where to take insulin. If you need help in taking insulin, then that also should be taken care of. Then you should be able to recognize symptoms. If you have very high glucose, then you'll have physical weakness, you'll have lethargy, agitation, confusion. In older adults, it's very important that we actually see the symptoms. And low blood glucose is equally important. The reason being, I, as a geriatrician, am really worried about you having suddenly low glucose because it can cause nervousness, shaking, sweating, confusion. At that time, I'm not sure what things you are doing. For example, you can actually have a fall. You can be unstable. If it is in the bathroom, you can have a fall. So those are all risk factors to a great extent. So that's why I often tell my patients that strict control of sugars is not that good. You should have an adequate control. Sugar should not be consistently going below 100, especially in the morning or in the night, because you suddenly might end up falling, or you will not be able to even know if you've actually lost your consciousness because of those sugars. Then always try to keep small chocolates or maybe even small things accessible to you near your bed, in the kitchen, in the bathroom, so that if at all you feel that your sugars is actually going low, you are able to take it immediately. Very, very important that you understand, if you are on treatment for sugars, that you understand that what medications you are taking, why you are taking it, what you are taking it, what are the common side effects of those particular medications. For example, insulin can cause low sugars as well if taken in overdose. So things like that you should know. And it's very important you manage your stress. Now you need to know that you have diabetes. So try to schedule things in which you can socialize, keep a positive attitude, keep talking about your disease, exercise, learn relaxation techniques, because stress is very, very important as far as diabetes control is concerned. Now, dealing with complications of diabetes. Now, this is another very important. Why? Because heart disease, blood vessel problems, nerve problems, kidney problems, foot problems, eye problems, these are all very common. So heart disease, to manage that, you need to obviously keep your sugars under control. You need to lose your weight, increase physical activity, quit smoking. For foot care, it's very important that you actually wear the right footwear. Because if you're having frequent slippage of chappals and your sensations are so poor, you will not even be able to know whether you're actually touching the ground or whether you are actually having sensation. Because a lot of times our patients have just come with ulcers and we realize that they had no sensation whatsoever. Eye care is very important because diabetes retinopathy, which is known as, is one of the complications, and there are treatment options earlier that detected the better. And other ways, of course, of preventing is, as always, we need to review your pills, have urine tests for albumin, as I said, see your dentist also. The reason being that diabetes side effects like gum problems, teeth problems can also come. So you need to be taking care of that. Protect your skin as well, because skin tears and skin, this can obviously give you a risk of skin bed sores, which can be a big problem as far as diabetes is concerned. Now, there are certain points which are very unique to older adults in diabetes and other things. Quality of life can be severely affected, especially eye, strokes, heart disease, kidney problems, high cholesterol, blood pressure. So if you have all these things, then the risk of diabetes is more. Medication interactions are very, very important, because for diabetes, you might be on multiple medications and you might be on other medications as well. So make a list of all your medications and your dosage. Please bring all the actual medications. For example, if your sugar is actually going low, we need to be able to actually address it immediately. Then read the information about all your medications. You should know your medications. Then depression is another thing which are very common with diabetes, whether it's lack of control or the fact that you have diabetes, So screening of depression is very commonly do, and because depression is treatable. Memory loss can also happen with diabetes if the person has got diabetes long standing. So that's why things like memory activities should be done. Urinary incontinence is also common with diabetes. This risk of falls, why? Because there could be a numbness, tingling sensation, and not having sensation at all. So that can be a risk. And of course, chronic pain. Now, pain is usually nervous pain, neuropathic pain, which is very severe and very, very taxing as far as old people are concerned. So the bottom line with diabetes is a condition which cannot be completely changed or completely reversed, but it has to be controlled. And the control can only be got by yourself. So you have to show your dedication, determination with diet, with devotion, have a proper regimen, eat frequent meals, make sure you don't have hyper, that is more sugars or less sugars, both. And ultimately, that's how you will be able to control diabetes. So thanks a lot for your patient hearing. I think we already have certain questions. So if you want, I can start addressing them immediately.
Yes, doctor. If you could, if anybody has any other questions, please ask, or you can also address the two questions that were mentioned to
him. I have one question. Yes. Arjun here, doctor. The question is HbA1c test, which is to be done. Do you need to be fasting for that, or you can do it at any time? There's some dual opinions.
It's ideal to be done in fasting, but it's not necessary, because it's not showing that particular day's sugars. It's actually showing the sugars of control over 3 months. Yeah.
Right. So when you get your fasting done, you can get that done also. So no problem. Same blood sample can be
used.
Yeah. Appreciate your answer. Thank you.
Any other questions? You'll have to unmute yourself in case you want to ask questions.
In the meantime, I'll just address these questions. I think the symptoms I've already told you, symptoms of really worrying, which are very typical, is increasing thirst, increase in pass in urine, increased hunger, being very fatigued, being very tired, having a family history and having these symptoms, you need to get yourself checked for sugars. Then severe symptoms, of course, can be numbness, tingling sensation in the feet. Those are all symptoms which are even more worse. That would say that your diabetes can be actually bad or much, much worse. Then the second question is, if we don't got diabetes until 65, will you get it in the future? If you haven't got it till 65, the risk would be less, but that doesn't rule yourself out, because if you are maintaining a diet and lifestyle which is being protective to you as far as diabetes is concerned, you need to maintain the same.
Doctor, there's a question that has been asked. I don't think she's put it in the group. What happens if they have flu black spots in the left eye? Is that a symptom or a problem of diabetes?
Black spots, as far as your vision is concerned, it can be of, various causes. So you obviously need to get yourself checked. The reason being, retinopathy, which I talked about, can also happen because of diabetes. It can also happen because of hypertension. So you need to see which is, of course, there are differences in both types. So that we are able to know once we are able to have a look at your eyes. That's why an eye checkup is always told mandatory, purely because if you go much later, then the vision gets affected and quality of life, as you know, will be severely affected.
Thank you, doctor.
Doctor? Yeah, what is proteinuria and how it happens?
Yeah, so proteinuria is basically loss of protein through the body, which happens in diabetes. Due to diabetes, the kidney cells, obviously, to a great extent, they get affected, and them filtering out the protein earlier they do not filter out so much of protein, but in a diabetic kidney what happens is that the protein is not be able to retained by the body and it is lost. So when that happens due to diabetes, we actually see protein loss through the kidneys and into the urine, and that is when we need to see that this could be a huge risk. And the proteinuria means that also that your sugar control is not good to that extent, and it is actually showing that the disease is not really well controlled.
Hi, doctor. This is Abbas here on behalf of Shirin Lakhlawal. See, my suppose that at times I feel a bit down, and I take a sweet bitter chocolate, and if it is severe, I take in a date, a khajur. Will that be okay?
Yeah, for that matter, for that time, it is very important. The reason I am saying, of course, we always say that it would be good if you could maybe check the sugars as well. But sometimes you don't have that much time.
Yes.
I mean, it's between checking the sugars and eating. So you need to eat and then you can check how low it is. Because if you're alone, you might just have that split second wherein you are able to make your sugars okay so that you can stand. So I think that is not a problem, because that is not causing a immediate sugar, loss of control. But if it is happening frequently, then yes, we need to have a look at your medications and we need to have a look at your overall control, because that is something which is, because the more times you have hypoglycemia or low sugars means that a lot of times in the day that is happening. So you cannot have recurrent insults like that of low sugar, because ultimately the brain needs sugar to function.
Yeah. Now, one thing is that after a meal, I prefer to take something sweet. At times I take it, sometimes I don't feel like taking it. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's okay. But ultimately you should just see where your sugar control lies and depending on that, because ultimately that's what matters. If you see drugs can work, but then drugs are obviously an additive. We should always remember, because the more the sugars go out of control, the more we go towards insulin. That is not because the fact that insulin is the only treatment. No, insulin is very much a last resort, because nobody likes to be pricked at any age, to be very frank. And ultimately, if you need to replace the body insulin by external insulin, means that the sugars are really bad. That's why I would say diet, lifestyle, exercise. These three things are so important in controlling your sugars, your blood pressure, as well as your cholesterol. And these three usually, unfortunately, go hand in hand.
Yes.
So once we control all these, an overall lifestyle will be good and you obviously will be much healthier. So diet should never be erratic. That is another thing. For example, once you are taking a very heavy lunch, then not taking anything for 6 hours, then taking very less meal, and then you suddenly realize that your sugars are going down, then in the evening it's there. So what happens, then it becomes very haphazard. So you need to obviously keep it at a level. Mm-hmm. And as you get older, I don't believe in strict control, purely because low is more worse than high. High can always be controlled, but low becomes very difficult to treat.
Very difficult, very difficult.
Namaste, doctor.
What is the random sugar normal value?
See, random sugars, to be very frank, the normal values, it depends on what your actual sugar control is. For example, if random sugar, anything above 200, that's not good. If your random sugar is between 100 to 150, that is good. Now, a normal value should be around 100 to 150. But if you're a diabetic who has been, for example, under treatment for long amount of years, then it becomes different, because for you, it will be different. If your HbA1c is well maintained and you're just, once your random sugar has come above 200, I wouldn't worry. But your consistent random sugar is getting higher, then I would be worried and would want to obviously make changes, because you have to see, the more the sugar is out of control, the more complications that can happen with eyes, with kidney, and also with nerves.
Should we take more protein if there is a proteinuria?
No, usually it's not trying to take more protein. It's trying to make sure that the protein loss is less. At the same time, try to take protein. Because there are certain medications which help in decreasing the proteinuria, one. But paramount is the sugar control. The better the sugar control, less will be the protein loss. And once that is there, then the supplemental protein can be given. But what happens if you don't have the control in sugars and we don't reduce proteinuria, then you are just giving more protein to be lost. That's it. Whatever you eat will just go out. So that would not help.
Yes. When you say long-standing diabetes, how many years do you mean?
I mean by long-standing, I mean at least more than 10, 15 years. That is usually long-standing. A lot of most older clients, of course, have it for more than 20, 30, 40 years. So, yeah.
Okay. And when you say old age, so what is that old age? Above 60 or what?
I would say I have always maintained old age is not a homogeneous population, is heterogeneous. So it is usually divided into three. It is 60 to 69, 70 to 79 and more than 80. So it's young old, middle old and old old. And in general, 60 and above is taken the norm. But I would also say it is not that simple. The more years you have diabetes, for example, if you're an 80-year-old who has a 5-year history of diabetes, then that becomes different. And you're a 60-year-old who has had diabetes since 20 years, that becomes different. So we need to know the duration of diabetes and other diseases as well. So not only older. I mean, older adults with diabetes, we have to be very, very clear about certain risk factors.
Okay. So doctor, since I started meditation and good reading and being happy and small acts of kindness and all these things, my blood pressure has become normal. Otherwise, I had diabetes, blood pressure, but now my blood pressure remains normal and I'm not taking any medicine for blood pressure. So I'm just trying to tell all my friends here that meditation and relaxation really, really helps.
Yeah, it does help. It does.
Doctor, the dal diet earlier never used to spike sugars. Now suddenly, of late, just a dal diet is spiking the sugar. What is the reason for that and can anything be done about it?
What diet did you say? I couldn't hear.
Dal, lentil diet.
Okay, the lentil diet. See, ultimately, I don't say that only diet matters as far as sugar is concerned. It has to be an interplay between diet, physical exercise, body weight, stress levels, because diabetes is not only sort of only unidimensional disease. So you cannot say that it used to work earlier, why it doesn't work now. Maybe it's other factors also which are important. And I would never say that I do not believe in only specific diets. According to me, the diet still has to be balanced. Purely because small frequent feeds are better than actually having particular diets. Because there have been a lot of different people professing a lot of different diets as far as that is concerned. But unfortunately, I think that is for another day. It will become just, diet and diabetes can be a separate session completely because there are so many types of diets. But yeah, I wouldn't say there is a particular reason. It's because it's a complex interplay of factors. So you can't just say that suddenly it is sort of not working.
Doctor Abhasya again. See, at times I after breakfast and between that and during the lunchtime about 1:30, if I don't have a meal, then I feel very, very, I don't feel energetic. Or sometimes it is such that by till 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock also I can sustain.
Yeah, so that's why we always profess that you should always take small frequent feeds. By frequent feeds, I mean 2 hourly. For example, if you have, I'll just give you an example. If you actually have 4 idlis for breakfast, usually you should split it. You should actually have at 9 o'clock, 2 idlis or 3 idlis, whatever. And then at maybe 11:30, you should have one more. What is happening is we need to make sure that the sugar is under normal, is under good amounts throughout the day. rather than making, that's why we never say that you should have three bulky meals, because if you see the night meal, night is when we have a maximum chance of hypoglycemia or the sugar going down, because the next meal that you take is invariably 8 hours yeah. or at least 10 hours. And then some people who actually eat at 8, it could be as much as 12 hours.
Yeah.
So that's why we obviously say small frequent feel is important, and whenever we are treating patients, the dosages are always less in the night, because that is the time. In fact, I would want most of the sugar control to happen in the day. The night, if it is even above normal, it's not going to do much harm, because because in your sleep, for example, if you go into low sugars, we will not even know, because you will not be able to express. And it has happened. It has happened with patients. That's why we always say that, I mean, as you grow older, to be very frank, I am always flexible. I do not say that, no, your sugar fasting has to be 120 and your after food has to be 150. No. According to me, flexibility between 150 to 200 and fasting between 125 to 150, depending upon the stage of disease. For example, if you have kidney involvement, if you have other issues also, then we might have to have strict control. But if you don't have and you're only an older person with diabetes, then we need to sort of get you in this. And there are, to be very frank, other factors like weight. As you grow older, if you have bad knees, it's not easy. It's very much easier said than done for you to just do exercise, do everything. But it's not always possible.
Yes.
So we have to take those factors also into consideration. But ultimately, I still feel things that are in our hand is diet is always in our hand. And to an extent, the lifestyle and the stress levels also can be in our hand. Yeah, of course, external factors can be there. So what we can do, we should do. But please never start any medications yourself, especially alternative medications. Always inform. The reason being, certain alternative medications can have steroids and they can actually put your sugars up. So yeah, you have to be very vigilant with diabetes. That doesn't mean you have to be scared about the low sugars or high sugars always. But discipline works. Without discipline, to control diabetes becomes very difficult.
If your stomach gets bloated and hard, is that something to do with diabetes?
Not necessarily, ma'am, because stomach being bloated and hard can have multiple causes. Diabetes can be one of them.
But I mean, she's diabetic also, but finds the stomach very hard and puffed up kind.
No, ma'am, the reason I'm saying is that when you are diabetic, your peristalsis, that is the movement of the intestines also, they also tend to get slower. So it could be one of the causes, but you can't say that is the cause unless it is proved. It could be one of the causes, because slowdown definitely happens. That is known as diabetic gastroparesis. But to be very frank, I don't want to go into technical jargons. It will just confuse you more. It can be because of diabetes, but not always.
I think we've run out of time. Thank you very much for this session. Again, everybody, in case you guys want to listen to this particular session, please go on to the website www.taresocial.com. All of these talks as well as videos are already on the site in case anybody wants to revise them. Thank you very much, Doctor, and see you again.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, as usual, you're good.
And Doctor, today specifically, we have to wish you a happy Teacher's Day, as you have been teaching us all about our health for the last so many days.
Thank you.
I would want to tell Happy Teacher's Day to all
happy
the older
Teacher's Day, Doctor.
Because I think I learned from you more than you.
And God bless you. Yeah, thank you.